Stockport. I've come to talk to you tonight about the what councils do and what we're doing in particular, and just to tell you the story of how we've got to where we are and why we're going on that journey. So the questions I want to answer is, what do we do, and what are we doing on this programme? So what do we do? You probably all know what councils are, but despite that, people still don't necessarily know the full scope of what councils do. I quite often, actually on a Thursday night, I'm not saying you've stolen my evening because there's still beer here and stuff, but normally on a Thursday I go to the Thirsty Club, where we all go to the pub, and we've been doing it since university. And quite often, quite a lot of my friends are techies, but quite often they will say to me, so what is it you do, and what is it the councils do? And you can just look out the window, and I encourage them to look out the window when we're in the pub and just say, we do pretty much everything that you see out the window. We have in some way got something in some of those pies. So from places, you know, helping with kind of what the plan is for a spatial area, understanding and supporting what gets built where and how that all fits together, to planning the infrastructure, the streets, making sure that there are street lights, that the roads work, to make sure that we have the kind of infrastructure so we can kind of go about our daily lives in a way that's easy and carefree. And we all know that that doesn't work perfectly. I'm not saying that potholes are filled all the time, because we all know that they aren't, but we manage those places in the best way that we can. We deal with everything from those bins, lights, roads, to communities. We help to support and develop those communities, to support the kind of infrastructure that there are for families, for older people, for teenagers trying to get into work and deciding their careers. We deal with some things for the whole population, and that's why we ask for contributions for council tax. But we also deal and intervene with people at some of the most vulnerable points in their lives. So we help and support people when they're going through relationship breakdown, when they're having trouble with mental health problems, addiction. We support people on all sorts of journeys, and we help people at the end of their lives when they're in the most vulnerable positions, and we help families to support their older and vulnerable members to be supported and live as independently and as happily as possible. So I feel that we do some pretty important stuff, and we do some pretty important stuff across the whole of the piece, really. So what kind of things do we do? If you kind of ignore the 48p, this is about where each pound of the money that comes to us is spent. The money for schools kind of goes in and out, but we still have quite a responsibility and a role around which schools are present and those places and the allocation and things. But most of the things that we have direct influence on are on this side. And as you can see, lots of people care a lot about their bins, for example, and the potholes. They do. But you see, a lot of our money goes on those most vulnerable people. And we spend a lot of money on trying to support those people in situations where there's nobody else there to support them. But we're in a period of unprecedented change. We have things happening with the population, with demographics. We have an aging population. We have a society where people are getting everything they want online, are having things when they want it, that we're in a period of kind of mass consumption that we've never had before. And people expect a lot, and they expect a lot quickly and a lot easily. And we're also going through a period of austerity. We're in a period of reduced money into each council, and the council is having to find different ways of coping with that. And we're also, within Stockport, as within other GM areas, in a period of devolution. So devolution is happening across the country, but it's particularly happening, as you might well be aware, it's happening in Manchester on quite a kind of grand scale with the Northern powerhouse. And that is giving us both opportunities and challenges as we go forward. So for us, change at the moment is the only constant. We have a requirement to integrate with our partners to try and cope with some of the austerity measures, to cope with demand, to cope with providing the outcomes for people that we're committed to delivering. And we're trying to do all this with less money. And we're trying to work and deliver some of those things around devolution in Manchester and the whole Devo Manc agenda and take some of those opportunities. So our response to it in Stockport has been to develop Investing in Stockport. So the vision is to have public agencies integrated across the piece, and for us to work differently together to provide those services and deliver those outcomes with people. And it's important to say that we want to start delivering them with people and not to people, because that's fundamental to the kind of public service design model that we're working towards. And we want to work differently with public. We want to try and understand how we can help them to realise their potential and take the most advantage of their opportunities in a way where they don't become dependent on us for services. And that requires us to think about redesigning our services and redesigning our relationship with them. So some of the principles and some of the things that we're working to in Investing in Stockport are to support people to be as able independent as possible in their lives. And so that's people who are having problems as a family, to mean that they don't become dependent on social workers, they don't become dependent on health services, they're not ricocheting from service to service to service, that we're providing services, whether they're digital or not, we're providing services that make sense to them and allow them to achieve their goals, not our goals. That they're safe and resilient and that they can thrive. Part of the whole devolution agenda and what's happening in Manchester, the basis was that we pay out almost as, we ask for almost as much money from the Exchequer as we pay back to them, you know, and how can we change that when we're one of the biggest economic areas in the country? How can we be more productive? And a lot of that problem with productivity is about how we support vulnerable individuals or individuals that haven't had the greatest start in life, how we make them as productive as possible. And some of that is about growing businesses and having the right infrastructure to grow those businesses as well. And it's about lining all those things up and what we can do and what our role and responsibility is in shaping places to enable that to happen. So what we've discovered from all this change that is going on and from investing in Stockport is we have a number of change projects. So change is happening within children's services, within adult social care, and in integration with health and the NHS. We're wanting to grow our economy and grow businesses in the area and provide the right infrastructure. And we want to invest in communities. And what we realised is that all of these things have some kind of digital requirement. We realised as we were going along year before last, when we started looking at investing in Stockport, that all the different areas of transformation needed mobile working. They needed better systems for productivity. They needed better interfaces into their case management systems. They needed, as a first point of call, better information, advice and guidance on websites so that people could answer a lot of the kind of frequently asked questions that were quite hard to answer from the way in which information is currently out there. And so what we decided to do was to develop a program, Digital by Design, that looks at bringing together all those capabilities and rather than services trying to serve themselves individually, to say, I'm going to update my pages on a website, I'm going to try and develop the case management system I use. Let's try and do it together as a set of services, and how can we make one investment and have one operating system that really enables and allows the whole organisation to deliver the outcomes that it needs to deliver in the most effective, sustainable and efficient way possible. So it's important to say about this programme, Digital by Design is a 2-year programme, but it's not a one-off change. It's about setting ourselves up for the future and about creating an organisation that can deliver sustainably the outcomes that we want to deliver. So the journey so far. So we started early last year. Was it early last year or even the year before? What year are we in? Looking at where we were at in terms of digital. So we had a digital fitness assessment. And we found that there were some things that could obviously be fixed and some things that are very wicked problems around shared records, integration of information, particularly around integration of information across organisations. We did a lot of work to understand at a strategic level what it is we wanted to do and what it is we wanted to deliver. And we got to the point where we could clearly articulate that to our members, to our senior management, and we were able to agree an investment to support this change on this level and this scale in a 2-year program to deliver capability. So we had the investment agreed. and we did the research, and what we found is that what people wanted generally was a better website, maybe a customer portal, maybe information like you get on Amazon, where, you know, it changes because it knows what you want and it knows what you've bought. How can we, people were saying, how can we use some of that? How can we use some of that so that we're targeting information to families so that we know that they've got X service about mental health? Can we promote this other club or activity or something to them? So lots of people came up with lots of requirements around what they wanted. So what we did next was try and decide what to do next. We went to the market. We thought, are there things that we can buy? How can we deliver this to the services? How can we deliver what they need? And we spent quite a long period of time testing the market. And what we found out is that we weren't quite sure what we wanted to buy. and that actually, when you start looking at the options, you end up being more confused than you perhaps were when you started. But I think we discovered that a number of things were important to us. And I think what we found out was that there wasn't going to be one big solution out there that was right for us. And what we found out was that there was probably a benefit to building things in a way that was modular and had standards that could be transferable across, and that we could potentially look at the work that GDS was doing and some of the standards there around open data and interoperability that would enable us to deliver some of our business requirements around sustainability and around delivering the outcomes that we wanted with the resources that we have. And what we found out is that we didn't want to make any big decisions, and maybe what we needed to do was do some incremental changes that set us up to be able to continue to make those changes and to deliver continuous value to the business over the longer term. So what we then decided to do was look at the GDS framework, look at the work that was out there already, and perhaps do a discovery. So that's what we went into. We procured a discovery off the digital services framework. Thoughtworks and another partner have come in and are doing that work. So looking at both user research and also at the kind of architecture that we need to deliver some of our business requirements. So since January, we have been going through discovery. We have been doing lots of these things in quite a high-paced way. I think we have embraced Agile and the process. We have tried to get the business and tech closer together. We have started a lot of those conversations, and a lot of those relationships are forming, which is valuable and rich and rewarding and will allow us to move at pace as we go forward. We've now looked at saying, what's after discovery? What's after discovery? So we're wanting to move into delivery. So we're looking at setting up a program with a number of different areas in order to support ourselves towards our next release. So in the two-year program, we looked at a first release, which was primarily getting our house in order, I suppose is the best way of summarizing it. What quick improvements can we make on the website to mean that we don't have broken links, we don't have information that feels out of date? What can we do to maybe put some other things in place that help people in the interim whilst we develop a longer term solution? We're now looking at a second release. So that's going to be a bigger kind of step change. What we want to do is create a new website with kind of portal functionality where appropriate. We want to deliver some ability to share records and get a single view of the customer. We want a better approach to case management. We want to deliver a step change in that for this summer. And then we want to move into a model of continuous delivery. What we're looking at in terms of a program outline on the technical side, and there are a lot of other programs that complement this around the rest of the program in terms of organizational development, training, support to the customer, assisted digital, etc. But what we're looking in terms of program delivery is having four development teams to deliver some of the capabilities we've identified in discovery, and a program management team providing some of those specialist skills into those delivery teams. And what we're hoping is that we can deliver that that kind of beta phase, and we can deliver the kind of the products that we want to deliver to the services by that summer. And then we can set ourselves up into a continuous delivery phase. We recognise that, you know, having a big bang approach in the summer isn't necessarily a very agile thing to do, but what we can do is we can make that step change and then moving into a way of continuous delivery, delivering value to businesses on an ongoing approach, in a way that fits with local government, really. I think there are some tensions there about how we do that within a democratic governance framework, but I think we can move to the point where we're delivering value to people and we're making changes, you know, to website content and to the views that staff have, to the way that staff work on a continuous basis. And that's our aim as we go forward towards the end of the programme and into the 2017 and beyond. Paul is going to speak in some more detail about the technical side of things, and then there'll be time for questions and things. Shall we leave questions until the end of yours, Paul?
Just that? I don't mind, really.
Yeah.
Probably
won't. Has anyone has a burning question about local government? You do have a burning question. Wow. Are you a plant? You're a human.
There's one kind of really quite, I think, very quote-unquote un-agile thing about working with local council, and that's the procurement process.
Yeah.
It's probably the, why is it we're laughing? that's probably the biggest, heaviest, most lumbering thing, especially for SMEs in the
UK. Yeah,
is
yeah.
there any focus in this plan or in the future on changing that?
So some of those things are not necessarily within our gift, but I think within the existing frameworks, we will do everything possible to support small and medium enterprises. We are working through digital services framework at the moment, which seeks to break down work into smaller compartments to support that. I personally think that digital services for us is the best way for us to deliver at the pace that we need to deliver for this programme, and we are very time constrained. But I don't think that digital services does enough to support small and medium enterprises. I think it's quite a big endeavour to get on those frameworks. And so there's not quite enough there. We are looking at other parts of the programme, and there will be smaller chunks. And where possible, if there's a smaller chunk that we can procure and go directly to market. But we have a lot of procurement rules that once you get above a certain value, and tech is quite an expensive area to procure, and so you're very quickly into ODU basically, and then you're looking at a 6-month procurement process. And that they're rules that we're not necessarily, it's not necessarily within our gift to change. But we can certainly try and influence and do the best that we can with the rules and regulations that we have to work with. It's definitely something that both us as a team and our elected member, who's the kind of sponsor of this programme, is very, very keen on supporting. Are there any other questions before we move into pure IT?
I don't know if it's a technical challenge or a cultural thing, but you're talking about waiting to do continuous delivery. What were the key challenges, or are the key challenges in making that a future thing, not a right now thing?
Why are we not just moving straight into continuous delivery?
Yeah, it sounds like there'd be some big obstacles to that. And
I suppose it's interesting. I think because we'll probably need to do a lot of work internally to make sure that we're delivering what the services need up until that release, and then we then need to go through a governance process, I think, of making that step change, you know, and working with elected members, etc., to get those big changes signed off. And I think part of the process is us showing that we can deliver. So once we've shown that we can deliver and we deliver good stuff in this process, then maybe we can then move towards, say, I think once we've signed off, say, for example, a new website, it's really easy to then update and change a new website. I think we probably need sign off on that kind of step change, but then we don't have to get sign off on correcting a typo on the website. I don't think we'll need to get sign off on some of the kind of medium-sized changes, and a lot of those medium-sized changes are where you get the benefits from. I think a lot of the benefits, once we've made that step change, will be about kind of marginal gains of the way in which we're presenting information, advice and guidance, etc. And that so it's about trying to understand the twin track of the kind of governance processes and which ones need to go through a formal thing. I think some of it as well is about saying, can we take this opportunity to take some of it is about comms and comms to the public, and can we take them on a step change in the summer on some of the changing expectations and relationship that we have with them, and there's kind of like quite a big budget to some of that comms. So if we can do that at a focus point, so I think we've seen there being a comms kind of focus that perhaps is less continuous and is more at a time point in time, but that we might be able to do continuous delivery of kind of functionality and stuff underneath that.
Yeah, the release two is not that point in time, is not when we will do that big bang. It's a lot to do with cons and saying, these are the new things we've delivered during release two. We will be continuously delivering improvements, services, systems to services up to a time when we say, we've done this, we've done that, this is what you wanted. And so it's not saying we're just going to do the waterfall, we're just not going to just do everything and then here you go, here's your package. Mm. As we go through, we'll be delivering to the services.
But it is a bit of a kind of, it is a bit of a mix because we need, because we probably don't have the resources or it's not perhaps appropriate to continuously have it, be having that conversation at this point in time with the public. But what we want to do is try and open up those channels of communication so we can sort of set up the process of saying, and things are going to be changing and improving all the time, kind of thing. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Do I go for a pointer?
Time. Afraid I've made lots of notes, so I may forever be scrolling. Hello everyone, my name is Paul Garratt. I'm the Technical Project Manager for the Digital by Design Programme at Stockport Council. I work very closely with Emma, who's obviously the Programme Manager. My kind of remit is to ensure that all the projects that are running on Digital by Design are running in the right way and work with the tech we have in Stockport. We also build technical capabilities in the program management office, so looking at upskilling a lot of people who we have in the team to ensure they kind of understand, maybe in a very simplistic way, what IT we have, the infrastructure in place, kind of how systems work, who uses them systems, and why they are the way they are. I think that's kind of fundamental sometimes when you're talking back to the business. Sometimes they just have that single link of view of that this is my system, this is all I have, whereas we have an overview of everything. And we kind of can say to them, well, don't forget you have dependencies here, here, and here about why these systems are the way they are. I also work closely with the core IT team. So we have quite a large floor, probably about 80, I think 100 people who run IT within Stockport Council. So I work closely with Phil, Paul and Adrian, who are the senior leadership team, and also all the senior managers in the different teams. I'm going to go through the different teams in a minute and give you an idea of how Stockport Council is structured. It also goes through how we would like to change and how we'd like Stockport would look in the future. And hopefully some of you might want to be part of that. another thing we're also trying to do as part of Digital by Design is kind of one thing we've got to try and do is obviously resource the workforce, and that's not just we feel on the IT side. There's also a lot of other roles we think in Digital by Design, so VAs and people who need to be within the business, not necessarily within IT. So we are definitely looking for a mixture of roles. And obviously, I think today may be prominently IT, but if you know anybody, by all means, send them a tweet. You know, we'll gladly take them on if they're good enough. As I say, not just IT, we are looking across the board for different people. I'm kind of just trying to get you to join at Stockport today, I think. How it was, grey, boring, you know, classic IT. This is how things used to be. It's not at the moment. And to be honest, it's not what we've been doing through Digital by Design. This is how it used to be 4 or 5 years ago. You had set teams, they had set jobs. No one ever talked to anybody, you know, big walls between each other. You may be sat 3 metres away, but you might as well be sat on the other side of Manchester, to be honest, because no discussions, things like that. We went through a change probably 3 years ago, and we kind of looked at developing IT into a different structure. So this is to look at bringing in a development team, so purely around the development of technologies, building in-house products, building on top of existing systems we've got to kind of improve that. The content team, obviously their main goal is to produce published content on the website, but what we've done with over the recent year is kind of give them more of a role rather than just being the people who publish the content. They're there to advise, they're there to actually give bit more support to the services so that they can publish greater and better content, which obviously I think Emma touched on a lot before. Better IAG, better information advice and guidance is key to one thing we need to do in digital by design and across Stockport. I think if we can get one of them things right, a lot of things will be solved by that. We have our service relationships team. So this was something different that we brought in. So within Stockport Council, we have different services and we found the key service areas, it'd be better to have a team to be able to support that. So they have their tech experts within their team. They have their BAs put into their team. So in previous years, we had a BA team and each one would be distributed out. But in theory, we brought that BA team in there into each of them service areas. It made it simpler. Change processes were easier. It gave a bit more flexible approach to new software and systems. So we have the support team and infrastructure. They sit next to each other presently. And obviously, we might want to change that. They might want to be actually one team. That's something we might look in the future. And we've also recently been bringing in the business intelligence and analytics. I think especially with work we're doing on digital by design, we've seen that better BI, better analytics, and better understanding of our data is one of the key things we need to get out of this. We feel that might be a longer term goal to actually embed a kind of data driven IT, but we know that can be done. I was at Auto Trader, I think, a few weeks ago, and the presentation there literally showed kind of this infrastructure and the infrastructure they have now, which is all embedded around data. That probably took them, I don't know, 5, 6 years, maybe even 10, I'm not sure. You might be able to tell me how many years it took them to do, but it took them a while.
I'd just say 6 months.
6 months, yeah. With help of Thoughtworks, 6 months it took them. That was quite enlightening to actually work out how it can be done, and it can be done. And as much as you think, well, Auto Trader, local council, what have they got in common other than they both have cars? You know, there's not really huge, but to be honest, when you look at the infrastructure they had, it was very similar to the way we've got it here. And if we want to move to ways of working that they have in Auto Trader, the co-op, things like that, we have to kind of embrace that. So things we've been looking at is kind of part of the discovery phase is to try and change IT and to change it into a kind of a DevOps environment. So changing from having set teams, set out, set goals, to having teams that are multi-skilled, different people, different skills in each team. Therefore, you can deliver quicker. It's easier to speak to someone who sat next to you who is a dev and a content writer. They can discuss between each other and they can produce better content, I think, in that way. It's also key to bring the support teams and infrastructure teams along, because sometimes you can always find, if you want to whiz up a server, sometimes it can take a while. If you have somebody who you know can do that, it's nice and quick. And what Emma's been saying before, we need to deliver quick under this program. So having these teams in place is one of the things we have to do. Otherwise, delivery will slow. And to be honest, we won't be able to deliver in time. So, another thing we've been working, especially quite closely with Thoughtworks, is to change. Obviously, that is probably looking at Agile anyway. As you can see, this is kind of Agile. So Agile Stockport, this is the traditional way. I don't think we're actually traditional anymore. I think we're probably here, where we're looking at a kind of agile IT, maybe not as close as we should be to the services, but I think to move to that, that's what we want. We want an agile IT, we want a service and a services and IT to be really close together, and even move to an agile service delivery, which is services and IT is just one with the organization over the top. Blue sky thinking, maybe we can go to organizational services IT. You never know, lean enterprise. It may happen in years, but we are here, and I don't think local councils are going anywhere for a while, hopefully. But you never know, we can aspire to get to this point. So that's kind of a flavor of where we're going with the IT infrastructure and ways we want to bring Agile in. Other things we've been doing with Thoughtworks are kind of drawing out some principles that Stockport should adhere to. And I think we are edging towards the end of discovery phase now. So pulling out things that I think were key to what we've discovered over the last 12 weeks are IT has to be agile. I don't think we can deliver it any other way. We need continuous delivery to the business. I think to be able to keep the business on board, that's what they will want. They will want continuous delivery of improvements, of services, of systems, of changes, and I think unless you do that, they will probably think we're going back to the classic ways of, we'll go and ask you for everything you want, go away for 3 months, and then deliver it. Problem is, with the local council and the way things are changing, within 3 months, everything's changed. So what you deliver is not what they need. So we have to do it in this way, I think. Understanding the user needs, part of the discovery work, we had another supplier in who did a lot of discovery work, a lot of as-is and to-be journeys with the services to actually get a thorough understanding of what they want and also what they may look like in the future, and feeding that back to them, and coming out with some common capabilities which we need to build, some kind of common understandings. No, trying to break down that barrier that some services think that they are very special, they do everything which is completely different than they do. So somebody might not think place, which is kind of the potholes, the outside, what Emma said, look out the window, we look after all that. They think they're very different than the people who look after vulnerable children, vulnerable adults. But there's a lot of commonality in things they need, and that's a lot of commonality is tech commonality. So transactional forms, information, advice and guidance, being able to see a single view of the customer, of the child, of the family, and everything that surrounds them. So those are the things that we've kind of seen that are common, which we can build a platform for. A couple of things we pulled out there are open source and open standards. And I think there's a slide on again in a bit of kind of how IT used to be in local councils and how I think Digital by Design thinks we could change Stockport to be. And that's the focus around open standards and open sources. Open source code. One thing we are looking at, and which hopefully you will agree with, is looking at developing reusable tech. So not just producing things for ourselves, producing things that can be shared either with the communities or with other local authorities. Obviously, we've got this Devo Mank. It'd be great if we can do things that can be used around the other authorities in Manchester and obviously beyond that. We've looked at making sure we can use common languages and develop greater flexibility and simple integrations, really to make integrations between systems easier. One thing we've been looking at is web services to sit above a lot of our legacy systems. So we can use, I'm going to steal someone's favorite saying here, a strangulation method to kind of say, we have our legacy systems that are big, that are well embedded within our service areas. So build up on top of them to kind of strangulate them and make it have access to their data, access to what we need without being tied to their development plans, to their classic, you know, it'd be released in 6 months type thing. We can just do that ourselves. Obviously, there's lots of constraints there around ways systems are set up, and no system provider in their right mind would try and allow you to kind of get rid of them. So they're going to continually try and bat against that. But I think if we can build up an in-house resource that can actually support that and be able to work with the suppliers, which is one thing we've tried to build up in the Digital by Design program, is that kind of relationship with the suppliers we've got, an understanding of how they work and try to explain how we want to work. And they still want our business. So if they work closely with us, it's better than being obviously against us. Other things we looked at is working flexible. So, and has very much touched on this before, so I won't go too much into it. So it's changes to funding, changes to service areas. I mentioned before, 3 months time, if you did it the old classic way, things, what you provide would not be what they need, and you need to do it quick. Sustainability, so low cost, low overheads, again, fixing with flexibility. And universal access, so that's around mobile first, accessible websites for everybody, and moving towards that. I've got time on here so I can see how long I've actually been talking about. Good. So just a bit more on the Digital by Design program, and this is more focused around IT rather than the actual program itself. So one thing to start with is our decisions around open source and proprietary software and how we feel. Excuse me, too many beers. How we feel where we stand. That's moved on too far, actually. My slideshow has gone wrong there, so it's going to look awful, this. But in theory, we were down at the bottom, and I think a lot of councils are down there. But I think not only Stockport, but around Manchester, a lot of the councils are looking at moving. And during the last 18 months, what we've been deciding is which way do we move? Where do we go? And I think we definitely are moving more, there we go, moving up this way, more to open source, more to open standards. Now, obviously, there's a lot of things we need to deal with around open standards and open sources and changing the philosophy within councils. But I think if we can, we've kind of sold that, I think, to our members, and we've sold that to the services, that what in theory what we can provide in an open source way is better than going out and buying a huge, humongous system that will cost you millions to run. Why not just let us build something that you want? So we're listening to what you need, which is what we've had that other service, other supplier in to do. So they went into their services, and I think they're on board. And I also think IT are on board. So although we're not completely agile and not working that way, I think we want to work that way. And what we need is people who understand agile, people who really want to work and want something that's really innovative. I can't even say the right word.
Innovative.
That one. To come and join us and try and take us on this journey. So, and so the proposed design, Emma touched on it before. This is what we're planning to do for that first release two phase work. So there is a program advisory team. Well, I can't remember what you put it on yours. Yours put slightly different, didn't you? But there's a program advisory team which sits above four main work streams. So the program advisory team consists of lead BAs, lead XDs, lead devs. Quality assurance. I'm going through the whole list. I've got it in my head, obviously. It's not written down. I should have wrote it down. Not going to say that one. DevOps, anybody who understands DevOps. And that team will cascade down through the four work streams. So although it seems to sit above everything, in theory, all them people will be working directly with them streams. They won't be sat at the top in their nice high seat, big chair. They will be embedded in these teams. And again, each we have... There we go. So each of these teams, we have a customer services single view case management system. And things we've been looking at and technologies we've been looking at using are things like Zendesk. We have quite a clunky, large, I won't say the name, system we currently use for our customer services contact center. And what we've seen through discovery is that in theory we don't need that. What we need is a lightweight, flexible system that will be able to do that. So things like Zendesk are options which we've looked at. AIG front door, so that's a change in the website. Technologies we've looked at there, things like WordPress, Nancy FX, technologies around that. The transactional forms, end-to-end processes, similar way, technology is the same as the AIG, what we've been looking at building. To be honest, we have a lot of .NET experience in the Stockport Council, mainly because we've been predominantly a Microsoft house, and we use a lot of SQL or the Windows-based machines. We do allow Linux boxes and Unix boxes on our network, but some of the infrastructure team are a bit like open source. Oh, it's the devil. Oh, it's full of holes. Everybody's going to be able to get into my network. Oh God, it's terrible. But to be honest, we've been changing that philosophy, and I think through the discovery work, we've found that they're not that bad. We can really embrace open source, and we can embrace what we're doing. And there is a work stream we're bringing up, which is around agile BI. I mean, I think the word agile can probably be taken out there and can cover the whole program, because that's what we want. We want a fully agile program. And the BI team, we're looking for business people who are experienced in agile analytics, people who are experienced in exposing data from our systems, building them web services, which I've mentioned before, so anybody we can find around that. And I think I've only got one more left, which is how I feel about what's been happening. And so, I mean, I've worked for Stockport Council now for 16 years. Makes me feel old. But to be honest, I think this is kind of quite a big change. And I think it's probably the biggest change we've probably gone through in my 16 years working for the council. I think it's definitely been led by the way the government is changing funding, but I think this is an investment, which I think is brilliant to bring in. I think one of the key things we've done is also seeing that this is not just an IT project, that this is actually a services business and a council project. So although we do actually sit on the IT floor in our office, it's not an IT project. The programs of work which we're doing and the stuff we hopefully can get somebody to people to support us with are IT, but we expect them to be driven by the business and by the services. One thing is quite good for me is that I personally have been using open source for within the council, but don't tell anyone, for about six to eight years. Sorry, I have to say that. Yeah, you can ask me on Monday. So I personally have been using WordPress, using Moodle. One of the key things I did was to implement CMS systems across all the educational establishments in Stockport. One of the main things which kind of pulls out exactly what we're doing in Digital by Design is that the funding for what I was brought in to do, when the old government were in with quangos, when they just threw money at local councils, you know, go and build this, here's 100 grand, so to speak. They were all removed when the new government came in. Luckily, we built it on open source, so instantly you've got almost zero licensing costs to deal with. So what we've seen is if you use open source, if you use open standards, if you build in such a way that's sustainable, you can continue, and it is continuing now. And the system, we've not had funding for the CMSs we put in place for schools for probably 4 years, and it's still ongoing. So the schools can still have them services, even though the funding is not there. It's now part of the core IT that we provide to schools. I think this, for what we mentioned before, it's very customer driven, not service driven. I think it's a huge investment, and I think we need to embrace that. And I think the organisation is behind us. I think we can do this. So, sign up. So, if you want to, we have an email address, and if it's not to give us your CV, it can be just to ask any questions if you want any more information.
Start any kind of conversations about different opportunities there are at Stockport to help us make this happen.
If your pothole's not been filled, we'll try our best to help you with that.
We'll
fair you on. Or by all means, come in and speak to us. We run an open office. I can show you some pictures. To be honest, I didn't mention this, but it's different than a lot of the IT floor. We have post-its, death by post-its all everywhere, exactly similar to this, strangely. I don't know how that happened. But by all means, if you want to come in, drop us an email. We're happy to come and have a chat with you about what we're doing in Stockport. And any questions? Well, not the same one, is it?
No, not my pals anyway. There's actually two. The first one is, how much influence do you think Microsoft's movement into the open source space, especially of course AMR and ASP.NET, as weak as they are, will help you shift more towards the right hand side of that spectrum? And the second question is, is anybody else in the Greater Manchester Combined Authority doing this sort of work? So you do get
that. I think the second question is probably easy to answer. I think yes, but probably not in such a big way. I think we've got a huge investment and a huge chance here to change Stockport Council. And I don't know of any. I mean, colleagues from Stockport might change, might differ that way. I don't think there's anybody huge doing changes. I think there is a culture change in local councils to move towards open source and open standards, and predominantly that's driven by the changing of services, the reduction in funding to actually be able to sustain what we provide on a smaller budget. So yes, I think they are, but I think we're being quite pioneering in what we're doing, and especially that we're trying to in theory do everything for all our services. So there may be some which are doing specific services or specific areas. We're trying to cross-cut, so as Emma said, we're looking at adults, we're looking at children, we're looking at all the services we provide.
I think there is something, there are lots of other councils doing things at different degrees of kind of a strategic level. I think that we are quite unique as far as I've seen in terms of how we positioned all the digital and IT development that we're doing. Other people have parceled lots of digital development into packages of varying sizes, but the extent to which we have created a kind of strategic vision for service development and service redesign and then position the IT to enable that, so that it's the IT is already coming after the service redesign rather than the other way around, has kind of put us in a really good position to be user-centered and customer-first in the first place, hasn't it? Mm. And to join all those transformations together into one pot of money and do it at the same time.
Mm. And your other question was around Microsoft and their changing philosophy, and then suddenly realising we can't fleece everybody for all open source. In such a way, I'm sure that's what you were asking. I think what they're doing is good, and I think that's actually really useful. And you can look at that in a positive, in that you can actually use local councils can embrace open source and open standards in an easier way and a lot simpler, because in theory there's that cushion. You think we've had discussions with Microsoft multiple times, looking at their products, looking at their costs, and how could we embed something which they bring along. I mean, realistically, we could have done it, but I think we can use that money in a better way. And I think rather than spending money on licensing and doing it that way, I think we can use that money to either further understand our business, further understand our services, further understand our residents, and provide a better platform for Stockport to use.
I think it may be a positive thing in the sort of medium to long term. And it will certainly help us with any kind of transitions and confidence that we have. You know, obviously we are very Microsoft, and it would be a big change to convince the organisation of it being the right thing to move away from all that. So I think that would really help it. I think the main problem is that all of our exposure to Microsoft at the moment has been about quite kind of like heavyweight products, where you can't quite get to the bottom of what's out of the box, what's implementable, what some of the kind of drawbacks are for that, what the trade-off is, and really trying to get to the bottom of understanding how that's going to meet your business needs and how you can make it meet them, I think made us feel very nervous about the whole process. So if in the process of making it open source and open standards, you can make it so that we can be more responsive to designing the things that we actually need to design, rather than trying to fix something into what we need, then that would be a good thing. But I'm not sure if that's an immediate thing. Yeah.
So I had I guess another question about open source. So I love that you're doing this open source. Have you sort of thought about what that might mean long term? You know, can you see a future in 5 years' time, 10 years' time, when if a local council needs a change to their systems, they're contributing and they're using the same code base as you, rather than every council creating their own or buying their own solution to do the same thing?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the dream, isn't it? So the dream is that we all get off the drug of the big companies, and that, you know, to be honest, there is 350 largest councils that probably buy very similar stuff from people. There are people going around trying to sell us all the same thing, trying to do very expensive implementations. Some of the way in which councils are structured makes it very difficult for us to. We deliver lots of specialist services to what end up being quite small numbers of people. And if you compare us to GDS, we're quite often, you know, they might be able to have the money because they have the volumes to invest in some of the kind of digital service redesign. That model starts to break down quite quickly when you look at local government. And the only way we can really tackle that is by working together. So if we can work and do this, and if other local authorities can come on board, we can break that cycle of being hooked on proprietary software, and we can collectively build the software that we need, I think. And I think we're in a position at the moment where technology can actually enable that to happen, so we can collaborate better than we ever have been able to before. We can make those connections, we can work across different IT teams. The combined IT resource of all the local authorities in the country must be able to solve this problem. And I think the key is that, and the key is to try to find the mechanism to make that happen in the long term.
And there are things that central government are doing, such as like the Verify for accessing services. We've looked at Verify, and we're not sure exactly when it's going to be delivered, how it's going to be delivered, who's going to deliver it. But we've looked at it, so they're doing something which, in theory, could be used by local government.
Yeah, there are central government things that we can build on.
So to kind of expand on that, do you not think, 25 years down the line, all local councils are going to actually just end up having a central stream into central government? And then everything that you've been doing is just going to go, okay, sorry, but you're canning that because
yeah, and
we've well, actually, well, as a government, we've gone and
I think that's part of
we recognise that what's happening at the moment, and particularly at GM as well, and not just in terms of central government, is that we need to be agile, and we need to be agile as an organisation, and some services are going to become GM services, and some things are going to become national services. But we also recognise that when we get business rates, some services are going to be localised. And so it's not as fluid a picture. And I don't think the automatic answer of what's going to happen in 25 years' time is that because of tech, the answer will be to centralise everything, because I don't think that's necessarily what people will want. And I don't think that's necessarily the way to get the best outcome. So I think it will be a very fluid and complicated picture. And what we need to do is set up our organisation to be able to shrink and grow with those changes in responsibility, and work as a kind of community with other local authorities to respond to that in the most effective and efficient way.
Because I think from personal experience, one of the big problems is sharing data between different councils.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, Shropshire and Wolverhampton can't share their data because they don't have any interfaces to do it. And the same Wolverhampton to Manchester. There's no way they can do it. Whereas a centralised model, where you're all underlying, would probably work.
You could have a centralized, you could have some kind of centralized model that allowed you to then deliver services locally, and that's probably where we are in the future at some point. But how that looks like in terms of governance, in terms of local accountability and structures, I think remains to be seen, really. And it's not necessarily about it becoming a central government service or whatever. It might be just about us using technology and the networks that we have to create locally accountable services that make the most of being centralised or networked in a technology sense.
Just to jump on a couple of words you said around, I think you said can it, type word. You do all this work and then you just can it, it's wasted. To be honest, I don't think things that we're doing in Stockport will be canned. I think if we do some innovative work and we actually change the way we're working, central government and all the local governments can take them on board, local councils not them. Take them on board. So the work around, you mentioned around sharing the data, one of the key things we have in the Agile BI work we're doing is to be able to expose all our data in a standard way. So at the moment in Stockport, we need to work out ways of bringing information in from the police. There's a lot of work we've been doing with the NHS. Paul has been working quite closely with the NHS, and things we've been doing in Stockport. We need access to their data, they want access to our data. So under the Digital by Design programme, we're looking at ways of exposing that in a standard way. So in theory, Shropshire and the other one, can't remember the name, Wolverhampton, can share that data in a standard way. So a tree is a tree, a plant is a plant.
It's just one of those things where I think, you know, over time it might be a case of, yeah, you might have 30 different, you know, sort of technologies within the core that kind of then moves on. And I think this is a bigger, wider problem that we've got in the UK. It's not just councils, yeah, but like NHS, the police force,
it's the public sector as a whole.
Yeah.
And it's crazy in some ways that we, you know, it's almost a Whitehall issue. You know, they decide to divide it up at that point, and then it makes sense on a departmental level there. But when it then comes into a place, the experience is very fragmented, and then we have to do loads of work re-knitting that together to make a coherent experience for a user and to make it an efficient experience for the organisation. And I think it is a fundamental problem, but nor should it be a reason to not do this now. So if we can support people, if we can support vulnerable people, if we can make places better and help people to, you know, teenagers to get jobs and older people to get fed, you know, if we can do that now for 3-5 years, we should do that now, even if in 5 years' time we do something different. So it's no reason to not do it, because in the future we may solve some of the bigger, more wicked issues.
I just wondered whether you'd had any sort of insight to
when it was going to all be resolved. I don't know if it ever will be resolved.
My Dr. Who tard has just been
I'm not sure there's necessarily a solution around the problem, because some of those are very big structural and power-related issues to do with government.
Yeah, really. Presumably there is some central local government monitoring to know you're doing what you're doing.
What do you mean?
Well, you as a local government body presumably are reporting back to wherever to say this is what you are doing, and therefore the central government will know that Stockport Council is doing something slightly different, and they might say, oh, do you know what, you're really Wolverhampton's doing it. Or not.
I think
that's the number of the issue.
Probably not.
Probably not.
The thing that's missing that you just are articulate about, oh, we've got stuff that we can share, or we need these standards. The problem is that that leadership about the standards and framework that everybody works within doesn't exist. And it's this phrase, platform for governments, or is it government as a platform? And at the moment, unfortunately, we're not doing that, government as a platform. We're not designing the environment in which local authorities can work together, share and collaborate. So I think at the moment it's help rather than
actually happening. I think it's a journey. And I think that, and this is, these are big problems. So, you know, there is stuff going on in GDS to develop some capabilities that can be used as government as a platform. Local government is looking to see how it can reuse that. Obviously, local government through the Local Government Association and other bodies do have a kind of combined voice, and there is some link in various different ways of how central government relates to local government and finds out about what they're doing and how we work together as a system. But I think it's a slow process. Government and change on a government level, particularly on that whole set, you know, we're talking about how local government relates to central government and how change happens on that level. It's quite a slow process, and I actually think that we've probably speeded up that process with the work that GDS is doing and the work that local governments are trying to do collectively.
I think I'll second that. I mean, because I spent a lot of time traveling between here and London going to central government sort of conference service often. I was at HMRC Conf, and I'm using that, both the HMRC API and the Companies House one at the moment, and they published a whole load of them. So in a way, they're actually slightly ahead probably of where you guys are at this moment in time with some of that stuff. And not just that, that set of APIs can be deployed to anybody. I'm using it, and actually any council can use it. So actually, in a way, they've got, as I said, GDS have already set some of the standards for government work, and some of the central government certainly exposed quite a lot of that already. So certainly councils can take advantage of that, and there are ways of consumer driving contracts between the two sets of organisations anyway. And as you say, it is a balancing act, because some of the stuff is local. I mean, the business rate is a classic example, because actually a lot of that money goes out and doesn't come back in again.
Yeah.
So it's a bit of a weird round.
And it's coming back, and it's going to be localised.
Yeah, exactly, very much so. And that sort of ability to adapt and be flexible, I think, is kind of key to all of this anyway.
Any more questions? Yeah.
While change is very important and inevitable most of the time, it brings about one important challenge, which is resistance to change. So is there any framework in place to communicate this change to, especially to the community, the service user, if not the organization?
Yeah, I think we touched on it briefly before about, you know, some of that approach to the kind of the next release and then moving into continuous development. Obviously, there are areas of the programme that are outside of this, the kind of tech part, that are about how we communicate and how we work with communities, and how we make them, how we make us collectively be able to realise the benefits of some of the changes we make. We're looking at the kind of the communication strategy and how we support people on that journey. But I think we absolutely recognise that some people. There's different groups within the community. There are some people that are waiting for council services to just be easy to access, so they can do all the stuff really slickly online and it's easy and stuff. And there are some people that have for very good reason, got a vested interest in the way that the system is at the moment. And, you know, whether it's about engagement face-to-face and whether it's something like that, we have to take that into account in terms of the way that people behave at the moment. And that change is an emotional journey, isn't it, for people? I think we recognise that that's something that we need to go on with the public as much as staff and other people. So it's definitely something we're taking into account.
I'm just conscious of time.
Yeah. Do you want to have a break and then let Gareth talk about?
Is that okay?
Great.
Hello, everyone. Cool. Before we start, it's worth mentioning that people are retweeting Paul and Emma's talk in San Francisco, Boston, and where else?
Belgium, Virginia. So you guys have all just gone international.
Stockport Council has gone international, which is excellent. Cool. I'm going to do a talk about being a technologist and why I think it's exciting to be a technologist in the public sector, especially in local government, and why I think local government is an exciting place for technologists to be at the moment. So there's not going to be too many architecture diagrams, but there's going to be lots of sort of talking and opinions, because that's what we like at Thoughtworks. Generic introduction. I'm Gareth. I work at Thoughtworks. I'm mostly a software developer, but I do a few other things as well. I've been supporting the discovery team at Stockport. And before that, I've worked on a couple of other public sector projects for central government as well. Cool. And a bit of a disclaimer, I'm talking about local government in general. This is not Stockport's opinion. This is not Thoughtworks' opinion. This is very much my opinion. And I have a few examples of perhaps local governments or local councils working not so well. Those examples are not taken from Stockport. For the record, I live in a borough of London, so I think that's sort of miscellaneous enough. So, interesting, how many people in the room would consider themselves sort of technologists? So, developers or BAs or QAs or DevOps people? Good, I had the right audience. Excellent. So, I suspect that everyone is sort of engaged with local government or a local council at some point. And I don't remember what I was trying to do, but I remember it being painful. And this was a few years ago when I was living in an undisclosed area in London. And I was trying, it was something like reporting a broken tree or something like that. And I would get to a certain point on the website and it would say, please phone our automated helpline. I would phone the automated helpline, wait on hold for about 10 minutes, navigate through some menus, then it would say, please go to our new website. Then I would go to the new website, navigate some forms, and it would say, please phone our helpline. After doing this about 12 times, I kind of realized it may be broken. And that tends to, unfortunately, be a lot of people's experience of interacting with local government. And while it is kind of funny and amusing when you're talking about broken trees and recycling bins, it's perhaps not so much when you're talking about people trying to access help that they desperately need. Although in most of those cases, there are excellent frontline support staff who do that job instead. But hey, so we've already had a really good overview from Emma and Paul about what a local government does, but this is it from my my slightly simple-minded technical perspective. And there's a decision tree you can employ to work out if local government or if a local council is involved with something. So you basically say, is it a person or a place? And if the answer is yes, it is probably the local council's responsibility. Then you say, is it a person and a place or somewhere where people and places sort of interact with each other? And if the answer is yes, then it is most definitely the local council's responsibility. So places, trees, buildings, roads, libraries, food standards, all of that stuff. People, this includes sort of everyone paying your council tax, getting recycling bins. Everyone loves recycling bins. When you tell people you're working for a local council, they tend to be like, ooh, are they the people who do the bins? also, people who are in crisis or sort of very vulnerable members of society or children. And then there are the areas where these things interact. So getting driveways lowered for people who are differently abled or working out how many people and which children are going to which school. A slightly sort of more succinct roll-up of these is you can really fit it into three areas. Stuff to do with data, stuff to do with information, advice, and guidance, and stuff to do with services. Now, like, if only technology was good at doing any of those things. like, fortunately, most of those things are fairly well-solved technical problems at this point. That's not to say that we can just sort of automate the council and everyone can go home and things will carry on. This is more to say that we can, if you look at what the really exciting startups, what the really on-the-ball enterprises are doing, they are using technology to enable their staff to deliver awesome experiences to people in roughly these areas. sort of technology, Web 2.0, which has been around for over a decade now, if people weren't feeling old, probably are now. You know, it's all about data, better information, advice, and guidance, delivering services to people who want services. So in a lot of ways, a local council is a technology company. They're just not acting like a technology company yet. And the whole world just got really, really good at building technology which links people to services, which crunches data, and which publishes information. Here are some random startup and tech logos, because you can't really do a technical presentation without at least one slide which has some random logos on it. Also calling out GovUK and GDS, because they're doing awesome stuff in central government. But interestingly, this is also, in a lot of ways, part of the problem. And I think as technologists, we need to look at our motivations for the work we do in a lot of ways. So 10 years ago now, Time magazine called, they said that their person of the year was you, or more accurately, me, or rather the reader of the magazine. And this is basically the dawn of the information age, the era of hyper-personalization, of being able to interact with an individual on an unprecedented level. Technology has got really, really, really good at that. And the people who are really winning are technologists, because as a technologist, I get to live and work in the tech bubble, where I get to play with all of the cool toys, and you know, I get paid a very reasonable wage to sit around playing with all of the cool toys. Because I have all of the cool toys, I can order a burrito to my desk, and I don't have to go outside and interact with society at all. And you know, I am my own favorite customer. In a lot of ways, we build technology which allows technologists to use technology to build more technology, to buy more technology. And you know, we're all making out great. But it just how's everyone else doing? Because what is the point of writing, you know, like superbly awesome, highly optimized tail recursive code if I can't share it? I mean, isn't that the dream, right? I want to share. I think a lot of, you know, my satisfaction from being a software developer, and the satisfaction of a lot of people I work with, whether they are a designer, a QA, etc., is about putting awesome technology into the hands of people. It's about getting code I have written or interfaces I've designed in front of people and having real people use them. And that's why, like, you know, working for a local council is really, really exciting, because the local council is the interface by which everyone interacts with where they live. You know, it's the pavements, it's the roads, it's the chairlift so that you don't fall down the stairs and end up waiting for a hospital bed. It is all of these things that affect us every single day. And it's an opportunity to have your code used by all of these people and, you know, make their lives better. So a bit of a suggestion, if you'll pardon this being slightly self-indulgent, but sort of people engage with communities via local government, or they engage with their communities and their local services via local government. And a few of us, I think like a select, we get access to much better services via private means over a digital channel of communication. Is there a way that we can extend this experience to everyone who is interacting with where they live, using the same, you know, doing exactly the same thing we do for startups and private enterprises, by just building really awesome software? Like, it shouldn't be difficult. We've got to the point where, you know, we can have a drone deliver you a burrito. Surely we must be able to just make the world better for everyone. And this is what it's about, like building, you know, when you build something really, really well, whether it's software, whether it's furniture, whether it's a really, really nice car, using it actually becomes a pleasure instead of a chore. And what I really, really want to do, and I think it's an awfully, it's a long road to get there, but what I would love to do is get to the point where local services are, you know, are that powerful, are that well-designed that people actually like, no one's ever going to like paying their council tax, but at least it's not going to be a massive bull egg anymore. Wouldn't that be wonderful? So what do I mean by good software? I mean software which is sustainable and extensible. And for, you know, getting slightly more technical, I'm talking about RESTful architectures. I'm talking about automated testing and loose coupling, so that you have a high degree of confidence that when you deploy your software, you're not going to break everything. You know, maybe you'll break your own select little bit, but hey, you can fix that because your deployment pipeline is automated, and we know how to do this because we've done it hundreds of times by now. Also building like the web. A slight aside, the internet is really, really cool. I don't know if other people have noticed, but the internet is awesome. Partly, and I was trying to, you know, think of a one-line sum, why is the internet so powerful? And it's basically because the cost of adding a new piece to the internet, a new server, a new node, is really, really small in relation to the value you get from adding that node. So, and it's also really hard to take down. So if you can start using this technology, building on top of the web, RESTful APIs, Patios, all of that good stuff, which I'm not going to go into a massive amount of detail because, hey, we all have Google on our phones. Yeah, if we can start using this inside of local government, because we're using it in startups and enterprises to deliver awesome software already, we can start to make things an awful lot better. Just and what is good software? Good software is good for citizens, but it's also good for the users. So this isn't about cramming digital services down everyone's throats. But it is about making the life of the people who are delivering those services better as well. So that even if you're still on the front line, not that the front line is a bad place to be, you're better able to do the stuff you want to do, which is help people, and you spend less time wrestling with spreadsheets and like UIs from the 90s. Or, you know, papers and printers and all of those things. You know, software which is designed for humans and also to steal a phrase from GDS, so good people prefer to use it. Because that is the only way you will get people to use your digital software, is if it's actually easier and better for them. What is good software? Good software is about open source, open standards, and public data and APIs. Because local government is a, you know, it is a trust, it is a community. And that means there's no competition, right? There's no reason not to open source your API, because if someone comes along and does a better job at serving the public than you do, then you win because you don't have to serve the public anymore and you can use that money to serve other parts of the public. As an aside, there's like 433 principal authorities. Emma tells me that some of these are parish councils, so they don't count. They can probably still write code, or they can at least like a repository on GitHub. That's a start. That's like an awful lot of open source developers if people just... And we talked earlier about, you know, it's not happening, it's not coordinated, we're not quite there yet. But, you know, Stockport have just said they're going to open source their new web platform. So this is actually happening now. It's not a case of waiting around for someone to do it. It's a case that people are doing it, and we just need to give them that push they need to, you know, they've already gone global. They're on the Twitters. And finally, good software is, like, teams of passionate people doing what they love. And that means people who are willing to, you know, give up their evenings to come to a tech talk. So even if you're not looking, and this isn't a recruitment drive for Stockport, it's a recruitment drive for Stockport. You know, at some point, if it goes open source, if you've got a spare 5 minutes, just like fix a typo or something, that would be lovely. How do we build this stuff? I think, you know, I work for an agile tech company, so I'm going to tell you to do it agile. And, you know, I've read Barry O'Reilly's book, so I'm going to tell you to do it lean. But, you know, I really talk to customers, find out what they need and build what they want, and allow people to carry on doing what they love. And that is why I think it's exciting to work for local government as a technologist. Was 20 minutes long when I practiced. I must be talking very, very fast. Does anyone have any questions? Indeed, for everyone, because I realize it's soft. That was a nice, fluffy passion piece, so it's hard to ask questions. But if anyone wants to ask the Stockport guys more questions about real technology, go ahead. I'm sure they won't mind. Ian?
I guess I was wondering about, do you think there's other open source communities out there where we could learn some lessons about how to make open source for local government successful?
Yes.
For example.
Yes, I do. I think a lot of the stuff that central government has started to do is really, really exciting. A lot of the stuff that GDS has open sourced, even if we can't reuse it wholesale, we can reuse the ideas behind it. And in a lot of ways, they've proved that they've overcome the most difficult hurdle, which is proving that you can build software in the open. Because for a long time, people were just like, whoa, you can't do that, man, it's insecure. You'll put that shit on the internet and it'll be in China. And that's how the internet works. Right, that's how the internet actually. people have proved that actually if you build software in an open way, it makes you think about difficult things like security and not checking in your AWS key, or at least changing your AWS key if you have checked it in. And so it's actually, there are benefits to working in the open and building in the open. I think the other interesting areas, so I was part of something called the Decent Project a while ago, which was working with the European Commission to build open source, this was sort of civic sector technology. So tools which allow anyone to put together a political party or to canvass their opinions. So Nestor are supporting a lot of this. The European Commission, as slow and clunky as they are actually supporting this in a lot of areas. So yes, basically, there's an awful lot we can beg, borrow, and steal or learn from.
Can I just add into that? Sorry, I've just forgotten. I think like the humanitarian sector, which I used to work in to overseas development and stuff like that, they also got a great open source sort of community. And I think one of the reasons why it kind of works with local government as well is I think open source works when you've got a purpose behind it. So if there's a purpose to create the community, basically. So if there's already a community there where there's people who are volunteering, you know, an emergency happens, a tsunami, developers, project managers are going, right, how can I help? let's get around that and try and see what the tech we can do. I think it's the same with local government. You know, people really care about this stuff, and so hence open source community is available.
I can just piggyback on that a little bit. I think I don't want to overplay it too much.
Yeah.
But the example of a natural disaster, if you care about the public sector and you care about public services, it's seriously, seriously under the cosh at the moment. And we can either have less and have shitter, or we can do this properly and have good enough or more or maybe even better. It really is a challenge at the moment. Like, we haven't gone into all the kind of the financials here and stuff, but if you were a company and you lost 40% of your income, which is basically what's happened to councils over the last sort of 5 years, you would shut jobs, you would stop doing stuff, you would lay off your staff, and you would get into a different market where you could make a bit of money. The councils can't do that, you know, and the scale of change and the response, the level of innovation that it forces you to adopt when you have to continue serving your customers to the standard they expect is really fundamental. And that creates a huge opportunity to do, not just to catch up with the rest of industry, which is, you know, what we're basically talking about here. We're not talking about doing anything that other people haven't done, but to go beyond that and to go further and actually start to ask fundamental questions about the interface between people and state and the power dynamic and all that is definitely, for me, what's on the table here. So, you know, it's not, people aren't dying, but, you know, people are going to lose the really important services that they care about if we can't deliver them better. And digital's one of the most important opportunities to do that.
Can I just add to that, actually, because you mentioned about the 40% cuts. Actually, if you think about what gets done on other ancillary organisations, for example, charities, a lot of them used to get their public, so a lot of their funding from local authorities. So actually, a lot of the charities that do the humanitarian aid work, or even do it locally, lost 80% of their funding because it's a disproportionate cut. So the council take 40, the actual larger, wider organisations take 80 or more. And they start, I mean, CADs in particular, we start to see loads and loads merge and some of them close altogether because they
over 100. We have had to completely stop funding.
Yeah, exactly.
Some organisations and some activity.
Yeah.
You know, and not to overplay even more, we say people like that. In fact, there is a real risk that people do die.
Yeah,
you know, we see things around baby P, we see things around sexual exploitation, we see things around vulnerable older people. And the root of a lot of that is that we have very little money and we need to use that in the best way that we can. And there is technology out there to help us to do that. There are other things that we need to do to help us to do that. We need to work in different ways organisationally. We need to work in different ways in terms of relationship with the state. We need to work in different ways in terms of localities and being hyper-local. But the stakes are high, I think, really, if we don't get it right.
And by open sourcing, actually, you can enable everybody else to just, if they want to do something, just do it.
No, yeah.
If anyone's ever tried to work with the government gateway before, flipping heck, that was a pain in the back. I'm telling you. So actually, with them phasing out the gateway keys that they used to use previously, and actually introducing the central government anyway, and introducing a more open API, so just get a key, build a guide, and actually you can do what you like with it. So I think, you know, without kind of wanting to blow trumpets for local authorities, I'm apolitical, believe it or not. But the fact is, the tools going this way is probably one of the best you can do, even just as wider.
So apart from Stockport kindly donating all its IP into the open source, do we have one example today of anything that's been open source within local government in the UK? Just one example. I mean, you can't come up with one. Do we see that where we're going to get one? It's a 0-1 challenge.
I don't know that they've done it, but if I have to pick somewhere in the country, you've probably done that. Ager and Worthing, down near Brighton. Because there's a couple of guys who were a good few years ahead of us who have probably done it.
Paul did say he would open source the new IT standards and principles for the council the other day. So watch this space.
So is Ager and Worthing, if Stockport aware of Ager and Worthing and money so tight, why haven't you been knocking on the door of Ager and Worthing?
Well, I know about them because I haven't talked to them.
Right, okay.
I know about them because we've brought together, Nesta brought about a dozen people together, and there weren't that many. You know, there is a big question here, which is why aren't more people doing this? Why aren't people collaborating to do it? And I think that's a very fair question.
And I think it's because people are nervous. And it goes back to that question of having the confidence to use it. And I don't think that we are innovators within local government. I think that we see that GDS are doing some things, and that gives us the confidence to do things. So I think that we have elected members that are rightfully cautious. You know, this is public money. These are serious things that we're doing. We have to make sure that we have the right security things in place. We need to make sure that we're protecting the people that we need to support. And change is a difficult journey. And I don't think we have been in the position to do that very well so far. But things are obviously happening within central government. So I think rather than saying it's a 0-1, it's more about what's happening in central government and kind of trying to ape that. And yeah, we may well be the first local authority to try and do that on a large scale, but I don't think that means that it's an idea to junk or that it's an idea that can't be done. I think it's a step change. But there are people either within other governments in other countries or within GDS where they clearly have done it. So GDS and central government, they use open source. So they're not all paying for Microsoft licenses. They use open source kind of like Office. So in large parts of central government, we're not doing that. Why are all local governments spending that money? We've already seen that we can do that. They can do that securely. So it's not 0-1. It's just about trying to get the confidence to make those changes.
Just as a point, if the budgets hadn't been cut, would you have done it? Or, put it the way, if it got an increased budget, we just bought more Microsoft.
Who knows? I mean, that's very difficult.
I think yes. I've been in these conversations where people have said, I've had this sea change. I've been in like 20 years, and all of a sudden, I've decided we need to be, decentralized and open, and I've asked exactly that same question.
Yeah, the sea change is we've got no money.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So what happened between 2008 and 2010? Which might cause you to rethink your entire, career.
Yeah, so my question is more general. Is it being done for the better, or is it being done financially?
I think it's both.
Yeah.
When it's for public money, are they not the same thing?
Yeah, I was going to say it's hard to distinguish the two things.
Yeah, all right, yes, it's better use of
it. And I think it's very hard to disentangle the fact that we've had large-scale changes in the economy, therefore in public policy and in spending policy, from the pace of change within technology. So I don't know. If we'd all been tutoring, because we weren't ignorant to change, and we had Gershon efficiencies, we had 10% cuts under Labour, you know, Tories came in, it wasn't the start of cuts, it wasn't the start of efficiency. We were looking for new stuff to do and improvements. We weren't just sitting there thinking, oh, that's fine, what can we get some more money to spend on something that's mediocre? I think we have been looking for things, but tech has changed and the pace of change is happening so quickly. So it's really difficult to say that actually maybe we'd be in the position where we'd want to take advantage of things.
I think it pushes
us to be bolder. So we are being bolder, and we're probably being bolder than we're necessarily comfortable with. But it does push you to be bolder, and it pushes you to be quicker. But actually, that's for us in Stockport Council, that's a more exciting space to be in.
And I think, in a way, if that kind of pace and the pace of Agile and the pace of change can bleed over into service delivery, we can be a lot more productive and deliver a lot more outcomes.
So the government have done you a favour by cutting you money.
So yeah, I need to write to George and thank him.
Make it more exciting.
Yeah, I'm now.
Thank you. After that, my 2 pence piece from the tech kind of side. I think you're right. I think you're wrong. I think if the money was still there, we would be doing change. I think the IT landscape as a whole has changed recently. Maybe in the last, I would suggest probably 5-6 years. I think open source has become such a standard across the world.
Incredible.
It's credible, and people will use it.
Yeah, so you just catch it up, is what you said.
Yeah,
we'll
always going to be catching up. But I think what we're doing in Stockport is that we're planning ahead and becoming more
embracing
what the IT community wants. And I think using companies which are endorsing open source agile techniques, I'm not naming any, but any companies that do that, and getting people into work for Stockport who also embrace that is how you make the change. And I think we're looking at getting them people in so that we can actually improve our services on a reduced budget and to be able to actually make lives better for people in Stockport.
Just to add to that, one of the other factors was I'm from Stockport. Last year we went out to look for pouring products. We were looking at CRM solutions. We didn't like what we saw. Nothing on the market provided us with the flexibility and the functionality that we required. And I think part of that was prompted us to think, there's a different way of doing it. So that wasn't just about the financials. We just didn't like some of the products that were out there.
A lot of the out of the box.
They're not going to work for local government. It's a compromise. So why don't we do something different?
Yeah. And a lot of the other side of it is that even if they are designed for local government, so we talked before about Microsoft, etc. We didn't really like it. We think, God, there's so much work to do to make it work for us. We might as well do something that absolutely works for us. But a lot of the other stuff that is for designed for local government, you actually end up buying into something where their development timeline, and again, there might be 433 councils of whatever shape or size, but there are only 433 local councils of whatever shape or size. And that's not actually a very big customer base to allow any kind of proprietary software developer to develop on any kind of scale, and make the profit margins that they want. I think it then becomes, we have a look at the software and we have a look at their roadmaps to change, and it becomes a problem when we've got software in that they're not bringing on the functionality when the users need it, and then we end up in this kind of cycle of trying to make the software fit, and actually maybe we'd just be better to do it ourselves. I think that's the experience we had when we tested the market.
Can I ask a question around that? How do you tell if you're doing well? If you're in the private sector, I forgot whose quote it is, but the world tells you how well you're doing because it's sending you money.
Yeah, yeah. Very easy metric, isn't that?
How do you tell if you're doing well?
We have a comprehensive performance framework. so I could run you through if at any point you needed to speak very quickly.
The easiest way is just to see how systems actually ask them. Are you happy with what local council are doing? Are they providing the services you need? And if we're doing it in the right way, I'm sure they'll be walking around with big smiles on their faces, not complaining about potholes. So
it is a complex balance. It's a complex balance between most people being happy and some people being safeguarded. So we have a range of measures that we measure our success and the way in which we deliver the services that we need. But in terms of how we benchmark, so obviously there are a number of other councils that we can benchmark against and understand in terms of demographics and finances, etc. How we're doing and where improvements could be made.
Because if you look at Lean and Agile, it's all about closing a really tight feedback loop.
Yeah.
So those things didn't sound like things you'd get quick.
Well, I think there are clear feedback loops that we can get. So there are clear pain points, there are clear idiosyncrasies and problems in the process where you can really make marginal gains very quickly, and so you can understand what it is that you're trying to do. We understand that what we're trying to do is make it as quick as possible for us to triage and understand the safeguard. So if we get 70, so one of the problems that Stockport Family, for instance, are saying to us is, on a Friday afternoon, we'll have 70 cases come into us from teachers, from the police, from whatever, about families where there are safeguarding issues. we have to dive into systems or whatever to try and figure out and to triage those families and to understand who are the most risky and who we need to go out to. It takes them an awful lot of time to do that, and often then calls are then passed directly on to the police when it comes to the end of the day, because it then becomes a police issue, and then they don't have access to all that information, and everything has to be seen as like a red light, we need to investigate this. So there's clear measures there that if that reduces, and the amount and the our response and the triage around those things reduces, that is a clear success measure for us.
I think there are certain in the town hall in particular where I work, they would say that the underlying success measure is the ballot box. So I might propose agile democracy, in which we all go and vote every 2 weeks to get that type thing.
Surely they could just have digital clickers from home, and yeah, exactly, the ballot box, and they could just like
build something like
the voice
it,
or something like that.
I may suggest we finish off questions in the pub.
Can I do a quick one? Sure. I really appreciated the talks tonight, and I applaud the embrace you've got of open source and all the rest of it. But I wonder whether, for the greater good in terms of other councils that might want to follow, is it more value to them, not the open sourcing of the software you develop, but the being open about the war stories, you know, events like this.
And with us,
potentially.
We should do a blog. Let's not talk about
I can imagine from a software point of view, things like scripts to do migration of data from old legacy databases into new things. I can imagine lots of, I can imagine a tool set for if you want to do what we did, here you go, would be of huge value rather than here's the system that you're moving to. Fill your boots.
Do you know what, I think there's a couple of really valuable points there, and one is that there are things that are linked to tech but not tech. So things about the like the IAG thing, you know, like what is the best way to communicate these messages to people so that they can be self-served, and what is the how is that face-to-face time being used at the moment that could be replaced with a really really good information on the website that could free up face-to-face people to do really added value work, and how do we communicate that as well as communicating the tech. And I think that's something really, really valuable to hang on to. I think there's another bit that we have thought about, which is about, this isn't just about helping other councils to use tech, open source, but this is helping other councils to understand how to change.
Yes.
So there's a bigger change engine. How do you convince an organisation that this is a safe journey to go on, that this is a right journey to go on because of that ballot box, because of various other things, because of the risks around security? And there's as much that we should share about that and about taking people on that journey to say, this is the right time to do something at scale and not be scared. And I think there's a lot of sharing about that, that we should try and open the source at the same time.
Is it a safe journey?
We'll survive.
Do we have any last three questions?
Yeah, thank you. It's not a question. I'm just from ICT 4D background, information communication technologies for development. I have been in a couple of research in that area. And the global landscape is that this agile and open source is actually the future. And the companies themselves, like Microsoft, seems they have explored these opportunities and just starting, you know, to come up in an indirect way to outsource some of their products and allowing people to build up on them. So I think it's very interesting to see this in the local government. So I think this is the proper direction for everyone, not only for local governments or for the central government, but the global ecosystem tells us that open source participation and agile will be the future. Thank you.
I don't know how people normally shut these things down. So
can you kill it professionally?
Hand on the neck.